a special Sunday where we wanted to honor our Canadian heroes for the sacrifices they have made to Canadian people. Where we are right now, we're going to be having a little presentation to be led by Mario. And then later on, there will be our very own David will give us a poem, you know. Yeah, and he's really excited about it. And then we're going to listen to the message of God. Mario, please take it away.
So, on November 11th is the day that World War I ended. And for that, at the 11th month of the 11th day of the 11th hour of the 11th minute, we save a minute of silence to pay respect for all the ones that fought in World War I and World War II, and as well for the Korean War and the many wars that have been throughout history. So I invited you all to stand up for O Canada.
But the Lord brought us here in this great country. Country great blessing, amazing freedom, and glorious. We enjoy this country and all the blessings that it offers. And this is home for us. And so we share. And so we remember. And I ask you to stand. Give honor and homage to the tens and hundreds and perhaps thousands who leave home, leave their families, brave the battlefield, offer their lives. Some of them was blessed to have an opportunity to come back and rejoin their families, but hundreds and hundreds of them did not make it, not able to return. And today we're going to give them 60 seconds, a silent 60 seconds, just to honor their memory. Can we do that, church? Lord, we thank you for this wonderful time. Thank you for blessing our lives with people who love and love beyond themselves and offer their lives so that others may live, so that others may enjoy the blessings. And Lord, today we honor their memory and pause and say thank you so much for their lives. You continue to encourage their families and let them feel how grateful we are, even those who are immigrants who have an opportunity to live in this great country and enjoy the blessings. Lord, today we remember and we say thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. I would like to share, and thinking about the message on this Remembrance Sunday, I know it will be happening on Wednesday, but I'm just thinking about a message that will complement. And I thought about Luke chapter 17, verse 32. It's one of those shortest passages in the scripture, a probably verse that you can memorize even today. Short one, but it's powerful. And it is Jesus himself had spoken about this verse. It is in the form of a command. And he said, remember Lot's wife. It's a very, very short verse, right? Even you right now can remember it. You can memorize, you could probably add it into the depository of your memory verses. Can everybody memorize it without reading your Bible? Remember Lot's wife. Okay? That's a passage. If you notice, we are never commanded to remember Abraham. We are never commanded to remember Isaac. We are never commanded to remember Jacob, although they were great men in the Bible. Nowhere in the scripture that David, the man after God's own heart, we are commanded to remember him. Can you find the scripture that says, remember David? Although we have a young David here who does not cease to impress and amaze me. This morning he told me, you know, Pastor Charlie, I'm gonna do some poem this morning. I said, oh, good for you, great. He said, you know, I am dressed up like you. I told him, yeah, are you going to be a pastor someday, right? I'm imitating you. Yeah. I'm just smiling because he was really kind of very, very excited about it. But that said, David, the man after God's own heart, there was never a mention about, remember David. Or even the great men and women in the New Testament, there was no mention about remember Paul or remember Peter. If you notice, this is the only verse in the scripture that commanded us to remember someone other than Jesus Christ. And it is Jesus himself commanding us, remember Lot's wife. So let me ask you a question. What was it in Lot's wife that Jesus himself commanded us to remember? Thank you so much, Betty. There must be something in his life or in your life that Jesus commanded us to remember. So let's go back to the passage in the Old Testament, if I may. Encourage you, while still a girl is working on it. I will invite you to open your Bible. On that account there, about Lot's wife. It is in Genesis. Everybody, we're just having difficulty with our PowerPoint presentation there. But let's go to Genesis chapter 19. First book in the Bible. Okay, are you ready, church? It says, the four angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. Lot was actually the nephew of Abraham. When Lot was Sodom, he rose to meet them and bowed himself with his face to the earth and said, my lords, please turn aside to your servant's house and spend the night and wash your feet. Then you may rise up early and go on your way. They said, no, we'll spend the night in the town square. But Lot, he pressed them strongly. So they turned aside to him and entered his house. And he made them a feast and baked unleavened bread, and they ate. But before they lay down, the men of the city, the men of Sodom, both young and old, all the people to the last man, surrounded the house. You notice this? And they called to Lot, where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us, that we may know them. Lot went out to the men at the entrance, shut the door after him, and said, I beg you, my brothers, do not act so wickedly. In some other version, you probably will be surprised reading. In the verse 5, it says, and he called to Lot, where are the men who came tonight? Bring them out to us that we might have sex with him, with them. So they're talking about men wanting to have sex with men. So verse 9, but this said, stand back. And he said, this fellow came to sojourn and he has become the judge. Now we will deal worse with you than with them. They did not listen to Lot. They pressed hard against the man, Lot, and drew near to break the door down. But the men reached out their hands and brought Lot into their house with them and shut the door. And they struck with blindness the men who were at the entrance of the house, small and great. So they wore themselves out groping for the door. They cannot find the door because they were struck with blindness by the power of God. Then the men said to Lot, have anyone else here? Have you anyone else here? Sons-in-law, sons, daughters, or anyone you have in the city? Bring him out of the place. For verse 13, we are about to destroy this place. They're actually angel of destruction. And the Bible says, because the outcry against its people has become great before the Lord, and the Lord has sent us to destroy it. So Lot went out and said to his sons-in-law, and relayed the message, get out of this place, for the Lord is about to destroy the city. But they thought that Lot is just joking. And verse 14, as morning dawned, the angel urged Lot, saying, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, lest you will be swept away in the punishment of this city. But Lord, later, the Lord being merciful, and he brought him out and set him outside the city. And as he brought him out, one said, escape with your life. And the instruction is this: do not look back or stop anywhere in the valley. Escape to the hills, lest you be swept away. So they move. Verse 20. Are you ready? In verse 19 it says, behold, your servant has found favor in your sight. You have shown me great kindness by saving my life. I cannot escape to the hills lest the disaster overtake me. He said, behold, there was a city near enough to flee. And it is a little one. And the name of that city is Zoar. He said, behold, I grant you this favor also, that I will not overthrow the city of which you have spoken. Escape there quickly, for I can do nothing till you arrive there. Therefore, the name of the city was Zoar. Verse 23, the destruction of Sodom and neighboring cities. The sun had risen on earth when Lot came to Zoar. Did the Lord rain on Sodom and Gomorrah, sulfur and fire from the Lord out of heaven? And he overthrew those cities and all the valley and all the inhabitants of the cities and what grew on the ground. But Lot's wife behind him looked back, and she became a pillar of salt. So when Jesus said, remember Lot's wife, he's actually talking to this great incident, tragic incident. And the incident was Lot's wife. Her name was never mentioned in the Bible. Almost made it. But was destroyed and perished and turned into a pillar of salt. She almost made it. You know, this is a great message, because I would like to start with, you know, almost making it is really not making it. Almost made it is really not making it. Let me tell you, on the course of my student life, I have classmates that sometimes approach me, Pastor Charlie, my exams result is 74. You know, in the Philippines, what is the passing grade? 75. I don't know if they change it now, but in my student life, it was 75. So some of my classmates sometimes they will fail their subject, and they said they will approach, you know, Charles, I had 74. I almost passed it. Well, 74, 65, or 50 is really the same. You did not pass. You almost passed, but you did not pass. Right? Now, in the sports, in athletics, sometimes hear people saying, we almost won it. We're just 1 point shy of winning it. But the one who took the last shot missed it. So you almost won the game, but the truth of the matter is, you lost the game, right? It doesn't matter really if you You lost by 1 point or 10 points or 100 points, right? So almost winning it is actually 100% losing. Are you with me? Are you watching baseball? Or hockey? Baseball is not the most popular, hockey here. You know, sometimes you're watching hockey and you got to, you know, you're watching, for some reason or another, he's the most recognizable hockey player nowadays, Sidney Crosby, right? Sidney, when he's sliding on the skating rink and doing all these skillful moves, really, and very close to the goal, and then he flicked his, what do you call that, stick, hockey stick. And sometimes, you know what? You just shout, oh, he almost made it. He almost made it. You know, but he missed. Now, missing it by an inch or by a foot is actually, you know, missing the goal, right? It doesn't make the difference. Let me translate that into marriage. There are people who just almost made it. My wife shared me a story about a senior in one of her transactions in the bank. She opened up, you know, and I said, you know what? For some reason or another, she opened up to my wife and she said, you know, I was married for 40 years. And Grace said, "Why is it was? Are you not married now? Did he die? No. He left me for another woman. Grace said, you almost made it to your golden anniversary 10 years more, and you're gonna be 50 wedding anniversaries. You almost made it to 50 years of marriage, 10 years more. I told my wife, you know what? It can be 49 or 48, it doesn't really make a difference. You almost made it, right? But it's actually, you did not make it. And some Christians, they started really on fire when you are a new believer. You are very active, you have this excitement, you have this energy. You have all this light in you because you wanted to do something for God. Some people carried on for 3 years, 5 years, and then after 20 years, they lost the fire. They almost made it to the finishing line. The Bible says, run the race. Some others, it's almost like in the twilight of their life. Like they've served for 45, 50 years and then they quit. I meet people that I really sad that they are on fire, but in their old age, they quit. They just lost the fire. They thought that there's nothing left for them. So they quit. Some other quit early, some other quit in the middle, some other quit in the later days and the later stages of the race. But the thing is, they almost made it. But being in that spot, being in that situation that you almost made it, actually you did not make it. And that's why Jesus is commanding us. Remember Lot's wife, because she almost made it. Oh, let me share with you this man. His name is Timothy McKay. They call him the Silver Tim or Silver McKay because he won 3 silver medals in the Olympics. But in his second silver medal, team, competed. She almost won the 400 meter swimming competition in the Olympic 1972. You know how many seconds? Let's go to the next slide here. Almost gold medalist 1972 Olympics swimming competition, but he missed the goal. He almost made it. He almost became a champion by 0.002 seconds. Oh my goodness. Imagine. He almost became. He will live to tell the story. You know what? I Google online. What is the most heartbreaking almost made it story? And he is one of those. Actually, number one. 0.002. He almost became a champion. But you know what? It doesn't matter if it's only, you know what? It's in 3 seconds or 100 seconds or 3 hours. He almost made it, but he did not become a champion. What is the length of 0.002 seconds? I did my research last night. 0.00 seconds is like this. That is 0.00 seconds. It is as thick as the ordinary bond paper. He missed the goal by just this distance. Like and he will need to tell the story. Said he called me Silver McCain because I almost became an Olympic champion. You don't want to miss your salvation by just that 0.00 seconds distance. You're almost there. You're like God's wife. Few steps away. Just few steps away, my friend, my brothers. She's there. She's almost there. But she cannot help it. She looked back, and the Lord is faithful to His words. The moment you do that, in every sin, there's a consequence. The Lord turned her into a pillar of salt. Oh, let me share to you 4 important lessons about the wife of Lot. Number one, she perished, though she was already out of the danger zone of the condemned cities. Let's go to this next slide. I will just share with you this very briefly. Her body was out of the city, but her heart was still in the city. Are you listening, church? The Lord told him, leave that city because I will punish that city. If you look at the story, it's not only one city, right? If you look at your Old Testament history, there were actually 4 cities that were burned. I know you know the 2, right? Sodom and Gomorrah. But if you look at your Old Testament history, there are 2 more. The name of the third one is Admoim, and the fourth one is Sibwim. Those are cities in the valley of southeast of the Dead Sea. And really, you know what? They are cities, flourishing cities during the time. And they are so wicked. And they are so abominable in the sight of God. You know, they practice all kinds of evil. You know, let's look at this next slide here that I would like to share. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love this world, nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. The cities
Sodom, Gomorrah, Admoim, and Sibuim did love the world. They're worldly.
Last Thursday, I learned, last Friday, I learned another word, a Spanish word.
Mundano.
Mundano.
See? Mundano means worldly. They're worldly.
They love eating. They love drinking. They love marrying. They love revelry. They love the world.
And they do some wicked, immoral acts that the Bible says. They love to have sex with men after men after men after men.
That's why we invented, there's an English word, sodomy.
Means these are sexual activities that are, what they call that, between men and men, or women and women.
Can we go to the next slide?
For Demas, in love with his present world, had deserted me. I like this phrase in the New Testament that says, there was a man who is so worldly. It's like people of Sodom and Gomorrah. To the extent that he left his ministry, he left his commitment to the Lord, and he abandoned the great apostle Paul. Because he loved the world. He's in love with the world. Listen to this. Listen to this, church. How many of you are in love with this world? And the things of this world? How many of us are mundane? Worldly. Well, let me tell you, the wife of Lot was mundane. She's right, mundane, right? Because she is a woman. She's so worldly. She is in love with the world. That's why when God told her, when you leave the city, run, escape. Do not look back. Her body was out of the city already. He was almost safe already. But the Bible says, her mind, what will happen to my probably jewelries. What happened to my possessions? Oh, my necklaces. Oh, my earrings. Oh, my coat's purse. My Dolce & Gabbana dresses. What will happen to those things? How about my appliances? I bought them in Sims. They are not from the bricks, they are from Sims. How about my home, my house? How about my friends, my party mates?
Do not look back.
Let me ask you a question. Was it really hard to remember that command?
No.
Was it complicated?
No.
It was not spoken in Tagalog, I think. I bet it was spoken in Hebrew that they can understand. Do not look back. There's only one. How many of you realize that it doesn't need two or three transgressions? It doesn't need two or three blunders? It doesn't need 100,000 errors and mistakes in your life in order for you to destroy God's plan for your life? It would only take one mistake. You know, I have classmates, they did not make it to college. Why? A simple instruction. They cannot say no to the urges. Would you not, during our time, it was marijuana. You start with marijuana and then you graduate from marijuana to another drug until you become addicted. You always start with little, right? We'll just try this one so that you are not that naive, you know. And then some of you are curious, you try it. And then second time, then third time, and then fourth time. And then you're longing for more dosage, and then you're longing for more drugs. And then you find yourself addicted to it. And then you destroy your future. It will only take one yes to the worldly thing for you to destroy God's plan in your life. Are you listening, young people? We're living in an age that is so much pressure. Where you have young women here, so I'd like to integrate this. The pressure to be worthy. Let's try it. You are already 16 or 18 years old. And you are still a virgin. As if you are 18 years old and you are still a virgin, there's something wrong in you. Well, the Bible says, sex is only for married people. Between man and woman who entered into a covenant and promised to God that this man or this woman, I'm going to love her the rest of my life. And sexual activity is actually a privilege and actually an enjoyment that God vested upon married couple. But let me tell you, you know, some men who are worldly will ask you, women, especially young women, let's try this, let's do this. Something that is extra, you know what, something special, something. You know, you will be experiencing some kind of a different delight. Then you did it for the first time, and then the second time will be easy, and then the third time will be easier, and then the fourth time it becomes natural. They even have a name for that nowadays to make it appear that it's okay. In the Philippines, they use the word lived-in. He's my lived-in partner. Here in Canada, they use the word common law to make it appear lawful. But in the eyes of God, it really is immorality. Are you listening? So when someone tells you and asks you something that violates God's law, will he ask it for the first time? No. Amen. No. Big no. With exclamation mark. Because I believe love waits. Are you listening? True love waits. True love waits. Amen. Hallelujah. Because love waits, true love waits. Amen? Hallelujah. I wanted to emphasize that. Because holiness is escaping away from our generation these days. Before you know it, you are married very early in your life. You don't even have a job. And then you're gonna be a teenage mom. And then you're gonna bring your wife to your parents. And then you're gonna ask your parents, all parents, to support your child. And then your future is messed up. I told my son in a loving way, do not do it to us. There is honor and order in this house. True love waits. Okay? And please honor your girlfriend, whoever that be. Do not ask her until the time comes. Okay? Amen.
Amen.
Make that wonderful proposal. And then enjoy sexual activity when you are married. And you have my blessing. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. In the ministry, I heard many times, he said, you know, Pastor Charlie, it's really hard to miss one prayer meeting or one worship celebration attendance. But once you miss it, and then you follow it with another one, and then third one, and then the fourth one, the fifth one, you will not even longing for the fellowship. You know, the first one is always the hardest. The first one is almost the most difficult one. So that's why the Bible says, it took only one commandment for the wife of Lot to break, and then it destroyed her. Never underestimate, you know, what? God is merciful. God is compassionate. You know, I will try this one and then ask forgiveness later. One mistake, one blunder can destroy your future, can destroy your God's plan for your life, can destroy your ministry, can destroy your family. How many husbands already in the course of my 27 years, how many husbands and wives approached me in counseling, Pastor Charlie, it's only a one-night stand. It started with a simple, harmless lunching together. And then it evolved into something deeper. And then you found yourself into this extramarital affair. One mistake, one blunder, one act of disobedience can spell a difference. In the middle of a very competitive game, one blunder can make or break the result of the game, right? It can spell a championship. So let's go to the next slide here. Jesus said to him, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. Do not look back. Keep following God. Practice holiness in your life. Number three, she perished though she was related to godly people. Not only that she perished by, is already out of the danger zone, but still perished. She only committed one great mistake and perished. Remember Lot's wife, she was related to godly people. The Bible says she was a wife of a righteous man. Because Lot was considered a righteous, a believer, a follower of God. Not only that, Lot was a righteous person, she was also related. Abraham was her uncle by law. Are you with me? She had the privilege to witness the faith of Abraham. We call him the father of faith. She saw Abraham. She interacted with Abraham. She probably ate dinner with Abraham. She probably worshipped God with Abraham and been married to the nephew of Abraham. She was in a very special privilege. She was related to godly people. But she missed God's destiny for her life, she perished. That's why Jesus is saying, it's not enough that you're related to a godly person, because at the end of the day, you know what, let me share this slide to you, brothers and sisters. Salvation is a personal choice. Your father cannot save you. Your mom cannot save you. Your friends cannot save you. Your Lolo cannot save you. Your grandma cannot save you. You know, all these loved ones of yours cannot save you. Your salvation is determined by your personal choice. That's just the case. You cannot say, oh, my dad is already an elder of the church. Oh, my dad is a pastor. Oh, my mom is a Sunday school teacher. You know that the building there, my dad helped build that building. So I will probably be saved because I am related to him. No, salvation has nothing to do with relationship with your loved ones. Salvation has something to do with relationship with Jesus Christ, and you make that decision yourself. I'm sharing this because you do not inherit the kingdom of God. You know that rich Roman ruler? He said, what shall I do to inherit the kingdom of God? We have that mindset sometimes. We thought that we can inherit it from our parents. The truth of the matter is, you make a personal choice. I'm telling you a story based on my experience because it is powerful. I think Ezekiel was 10 years old when he asked me that he wanted to be baptized, wanted to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. I was a little bit concerned that the first time he told me, I ignored it. So the second time, that I wanted to be baptized. So finally my wife told me, why not sit down with your son? You have all this time to tell the other people that are, others that are, about Jesus. Here is your son, ask him. So I was convicted. So I sat down with Ezekiel. And on his bedside, I asked him, why do you want to be baptized? Because I am a sinner. So what? So only Jesus can save me. So I repeated the question, do you acknowledge that you're a sinner before God? Yes. Do you acknowledge that only Jesus can save you? Yes. So therefore, I'm going to baptize you this coming Sunday. I did not tell her to be baptized. If I have my will, I should have waited another 2-3 years until he is 14 years old or probably 15 years old. That might be a good age to accept Jesus. But you know what? He went in it. We did not enforce it to him. Because salvation at the end of the day is not something that is dictated to you. It's not something that is commanded to you by your parents. It's not something that you are forced into. It must be a personal decision. Relationship with somebody, dad and mom, has nothing to do with your salvation. You must make that decision for yourself. Are you in the church? Lastly, she perished though she was warned. She perished though she was warned. But this warning, do not look back. But she ignored the warning. Are you listening, church? Let me share to you this man. His name is Harry Randall Truman. Harry Randall Truman was really a known figure during the 1980s. He was a newsmaker. He was a newsmaker in the sense that he lives in Washington, D.C., where Mount Helens is. And he's actually living on that mountain and was an intern or a caretaker of the lodge there, the Spirit Lake Lodge. He made headline because, can we go to the next page? The next slide. He came to brief fame in the months preceding the volcano's 1980 eruption, Mount Helens. After he stubbornly refused to leave his home, despite evacuation orders, and is presumed to have been killed in the eruption. He was the owner and caretaker of Mount St. Helens Lodge at Spirit Lake, located at the south end of Spirit Lake, at the foot of the mountain in the danger zone at the time of the eruption. If you look at his life, there was warning after warning. There was order after order. The government even forcefully telling him, leave the mountain. Anytime soon, you're gonna be dead because the volcano will erupt. And by the way, the Mount 1980 Mount Helens eruption is one of those strongest and most explosive explosion of this volcano in North America. And the story of his life tells us that he ignored this word. He said, can we go back to that slide? The mountain is mile away. The mountain ain't gonna hurt me, boy. He told the reporter. The reporter said, man, you should leave this anytime soon. The volcano will erupt and you're gonna be killed. But he said, no. How many of you realize that warnings are important? How many of you know that there are more than 6,000 commands that we need to remember as a warning to us from the Bible? Not only 10, 6,000 of us. Let me share with you these verses. Warning. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You are responsible for what you hear if you reject the plan of salvation. There is no other. God does not send people to hell. You send yourself to hell by rejecting what Jesus did to save you. Are you with me? Go to the next one. But cowards, unbelievers, the corrupt, the murderers, the immoral, those who practice witchcraft, idol worshippers, and all liars, their faith is in the fiery lake of burning. Remember what destroyed Sodom? The same warning is given to us today. Lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. But people will say, oh, it's not true. It's a figment of man's imagination. There is no hell. Enjoy life. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you will die. There is no such thing as sulfuric lake. Warning after warning. Another verse. Sodom's sin. It is Ezekiel 16, 49, 50. Sodom's sins were pride, gluttony, and? Oh, hallelujah. Lord, if you have in your lives, it's time to repent, brothers and sisters. It says, the sins of pride. Brother Rico just preached about this. Let it go. And let God. No? Humble yourself before the Lord. Acknowledge that you are a sinner. No, Lord, I need you in my life. I need to let go of all these things. I need to embrace change. And it changes for the good, for the better. Change that is to accept Jesus in my life. And his plans for my life. How about gluttony? What is gluttony? Excessive appetite. Too much eating. You're already full and you wanted to eat. The unsatiable desire to eat. Oh. Sabi-tabi lang po, you know, por favor, entiende por favor, you know, just understand me by saying this. This is a loving reminder and a loving warning. Don't you know that one of the problems of North America nowadays is obesity? Obesity, I'm not saying that all obesity is a product or a result of gluttony, but you know what, most of obesity problem is really our undisciplined what? Eating habits. Wanted to eat. If there's a choice between prayer and eating, what do we choose? If there is a choice between worship practice and eating, what do you choose? If there is a choice of fasting and eating, what do you choose? And the book of Philippians tells about that Some of the people, their God is their stomach, their tummy. They worship their stomach more than they worship God. And those are the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. Oh, don't get me wrong, I ate too. I have my breakfast, I have my lunch, I have my supper. But I need to remind myself of the word of God. Gluttony is sin. So there's a time to say, okay, looks good, tastes good, it's really yummy, but I'm done. Okay? Sometimes I joke around, I need to maintain my vital statistics. Are you not concerned about that? Well, in a light way, let me tell you, if you're a man and if your waistline is larger than 34 inches, it is actually your candidate of a heart disease. Diabetes. So that's why nowadays when you reach the age of 40 and you have a diabetic history and almost all your uncle died in heart attack, then you must be really, really disciplined. And what to that, you know, the Bible says gluttony is sin. Okay? Amen? Okay, take it from a loving pastor, okay? Don't go home, pastor condemned me because I am, you know. No, my prayer for you guys is to take the warning. Do you want to see your grandchildren? I want to see Ezekiel's children. So I wanted to live long, okay? That explains my obsession in my, you know what, exercise and dietary lifestyle. Because I wanted to serve God more. Hallelujah! You need a healthy body to serve the Lord. Isn't it right, my brother Jackson? Amen? Now let's go to the next slide here. And don't forget Sodom and Gomorrah. And by the way, let me go back to that slide there. Laziness is one of their greatest sins. What is laziness?
Tamad.
Batugan. Idle. They love their thoughts more than their work. They enjoy television more than their jobs. They spend 4 hours in their computer rather than, you know what, claiming the destiny that God has for them. They don't have study time. Abitabi lang po. Some others can spend 30 minutes in their studies, but 3 hours in their computer games. That is laziness. You know? And lazy people, they are so doomy. Okay? Let's go to the next part. And don't forget Sodom and Gomorrah and their neighboring towns, which were filled with immorality and every kind of sexual perversion. Those cities were destroyed by fire and serve us warning of the eternal fire of God's judgment. We are being warned. We are being warned. Beware in this generation, in this pulpit, we're going to preach the word of God. We're going to make our stand for the glory of God.
Amen.
In this church and in this movement, we do not condone same-sex marriage. We do not condone homosexuals. We honor God. But let me share that we love homosexuals. We love to accept them and welcome them in our celebration. We wanted them to hear the word of God. And we wanted them to change and repent of their sinful lifestyle. I have some homosexual friends in the Philippines. But I told them, you need to repent. And you need to get out from the perverted lifestyle. Because the Bible says so. Amen? Can you make the difference? Can you make the distinction? You know, we love them. We wanted them to interaction with them. We do not hate them. But we wanted them to know Jesus as well. So we said, no to their perverted lifestyle. The world shouts and said, it is acceptable. The world says, you are a bigot because you are following the word of God that is 6,000 years old or 4,000 years old. The world will condemn you for following God. But let me beware, be warned. It's good to honor God, than to honor the world. Love God more than you love the world. Let's go to the next slide here. The whole land is devastated by sulfur and salt. It is a wasteland with nothing planted and nothing growing, not even a blade of grass. It is like the cities, here is the cities that were destroyed. The cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, Adma and Zeboim, which the Lord destroys in his intense anger. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 6, later God condemned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah and turned them into heaps of ashes. He made them an example of what will happen to ungodly people. As I close today, let me share to you these two, three more slides. Hell is where people who ignore God's warning through his words will ultimately end up. Hell is filled with people who almost made it to heaven. As you remember last week today, what changes do you need to make? Jesus desires that your end will be different from God's wife. Amen? That's why the Bible says, and the world will be as it was in the days of Lot. People went about their daily business, eating and drinking, buying and selling, farming and building, until the morning Lot left Sodom. Then fire and burning sulfur rained down from heaven and destroyed it all. Yes, it will be business as usual, right up to the day when the Son of Man is revealed. My friends, now can never be too early to accept Jesus in your life, but tomorrow can be too late. If you don't have Jesus in your life today, be warned. Now is the day, the Bible says. As God partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. For God says, at just at the right time I heard you. On the day of salvation I help you. Indeed, the right time is now. When is the right time to accept Jesus? When is the time to repent of our sins if we have sins in our lives? When is the time to come draw near to you and say, Lord, I need you in my life? When is the time to open your heart and say, Lord, I want it to be my eyes. I want it to welcome you in my life. I want it to serve you all my life. When is the time? I didn't hear any answer. Now is the time. Today is the day of salvation. You know why? Tomorrow, you may not be here. Who can really boast about you'll be still believing tomorrow? You have only today. And if you don't have Jesus, if you don't make the decision in your life, make the decision right now. I'm going to actually ask the worship team to sing a song today and give that invitation to you. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, it says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, endure the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand in the throne of God. Why not stand today, church, and why not listen to this invitation? You know, the question sometimes is that where God, Jesus said, remember Lot's wife. She was out of the city, she was out of the danger zone, but she still perished. She was only given one command, but she cannot seem to obey. She was related to someone that is godly, but time and again, she ignored the warning. Today, God is warning you. Without Jesus, you will perish. Without Jesus, your eternity will be an eternity of sulfuric fire.
Hell is real. Let me tell you. Are you listening, church? Hell is real. Those who does not believe to Jesus, that's not connected to Jesus in any way, will end up to that place. I don't want you to accept Jesus because you're afraid. I don't want you to accept Jesus because you are being compelled to. I just wanted you to accept Jesus because after listening to His word, you realize He loves you so much. He wanted your end to be different. He wanted you to remember Lot's wife. He wanted you to live with Him in eternity. So while we're singing this song, take it as an invitation. Make that literal step of faith to come forward. I need Jesus in my life. I wanted Him in my life. I'm repenting of my sins. And I wanted to be baptized. Because in this church, we immerse and we baptize every person who accept Jesus as Lord and Savior in their lives, who acknowledge that they are sinners. Let us sing this song. And if the Holy Spirit is touching you, look unto Jesus. Jesus is here and is waiting. Tomorrow can be too late. Today cannot be too early. Now is the time of salvation. Let's sing this song.
and Jesus still is a consideration in your life. You haven't made a decision yet. Don't be contemplating, you know what? I have time in my hands. Now I really encourage you to think about this seriously and pray about that. And if you make a decision, let us know. Reach out to one of the elders. After the service, we can continue to have this interaction. And if you wanted to be baptized, just approach me or one of our elders or even one of our ushers. Let us know. Be careful as God cares for you. We love you as God loves you. That's why we're warning you. And that's why we're offering you Jesus. Another thing is that if you're serving the Lord right now, I really wanted you to remember that it doesn't really matter how much you started. God is not about starters. He's about finishers. God wanted you to finish the race. God wanted you to complete the marathon. God wanted you to fight and fight and fight. God wanted you to carry on. Do not give up. Challenges will come, adversities will come, hindrances will come, and obstacles will come. You know, do not be like Lot's wife. She almost made it. You know, God wanted you to make it. God wanted you to make it in heaven and spend eternity with Him. No eyes have heard. No ears have heard. No eyes have seen. Or entered into man's imagination what God has prepared for us. Jesus loves you. And let this be your thought as we live.